All right, so this is lecture number 7 in heat transfer. In the previous few lectures on heat conduction, we've been talking about the equation, the heat conduction equation. So in 2 lectures ago, I derived the equation of heat conduction. And then in the last lecture, we applied that to a 1D steady situation. So we took this glass window of ours where the temperature is changing. So the left hand side of the glass window had a temperature which was different from the right hand side of the glass window. So we had a T left and a T right. And can you please confirm I've started using a new pen, which is a bit thin and nib. So are these lines visible to you clearly?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So over time, the pen opens up and then you'll see thicker lines. So we took a 1D steady situation. So we considered a case where it was steady, 1D. And we also assumed that the thermal conductivity K was homogeneous and isotropic as well. Given these conditions, and we also assumed that the heat generation was zero. So these were the 4 assumptions we took. And for that, we got a heat equation, which was given as D2 temperature by D times squared equals zero. So for these, we solved this equation, and what we got was, we got a linear profile. So that is something I discussed with you. So we end up getting a linear profile for temperature. And the solution we had was T as a function of X was T left plus X times TR minus T left by L, where L was the thickness of this plate. You can check that. So if you put X equals 0, you get TL, which is your left boundary condition. If you put X equals L, which is your right hand side boundary, you get TR, which is your right boundary condition. So this satisfies your two boundary conditions and also is linear. So that is what we got for this. So today, what we'll be doing is we'll be analyzing this in a bit more detail, and we'll be developing the idea of the thermal resistance, and that will help us come up with laminated sheets and the corresponding thermal resistance to those. Okay, so we'll be working with this a lot more today. So continuing with my recap, so we also talked briefly in the last lecture about what happens when my K, the thermal conductivity, becomes non-homogeneous. It is quite possible. And we also talked about the situation where K becomes anisotropic. And particularly, it's very common to experience materials which are orthotropic. Okay. So it is still a diagonal, the tensor is still a diagonal matrix, but the diagonal terms are not the same. So that's an orthotropic material. Okay. So the heat flow will only depend on the heat, rate of temperature gradients in that particular direction, not in the other directions, but the K values will be different for different directions of heat flow. Okay. So today, first, we will start with boundary conditions. We'll talk a bit about what sort of boundary conditions can we experience, and then we'll come back to this example. So I won't erase this because I'll be needing this again soon. Okay, so mathematically, the heat conduction, the heat equation, or the heat diffusion equation, whatever you want to call it, the equation we got was a second order partial differential equation. Let me write that again. So this is nothing but the divergence of K grad T, and this was equal to rho Cp times partial temperature by partial time. I've assumed that Q dot is equal to zero. So no generation is assumed in this case. This is just for representation. So this is the general heat conduction equation without generation. So let's see. So it's a second order partial differential equation in space. So what that means is that you have two constants of integration in space. So that means you need two boundary conditions to find those two constants. So boundary conditions are conditions which for this equation, I mean, they physically mean something. Okay, so they can be of different kinds depending on what sort of boundary condition is available to us. So the first one is called the Dirichlet boundary condition. So that's after the mathematician Dirichlet. So in this boundary condition, the value of the unknown, that is the temperature here, because we are solving this equation for temperature field. So the value of the unknown is given to us. So that means T at some boundary is given. Ts is nothing but I call it a T specified. So this is temperature field at some boundary x equals x naught, where x equals x naught is the boundary. So in this case, x naught is 0 for the left boundary and x naught is L for the right boundary. So I call this x equal to 0 and this is x equal to L. So this is for a given boundary, it is specified. So Ts is a value that is known to us. Okay. So this is called a Dirichlet boundary condition. And again, for example, in this case, both the left and right boundaries were Dirichlet. So the temperature value was given. It's quite common to work with this. So if you take this left boundary and dip it in melting ice, okay, so this is how you can ensure that the temperature here is equal to some specified value. Okay, so whenever you experience these situations, then you'll be applying this Dirichlet boundary condition. But this is all a mathematical idea. I mean, when is a given boundary Dirichlet is something you have to figure out while understanding and modeling the system. The second kind of boundary condition, which is again very common, is called the Neumann boundary condition. Okay, again named after von Neumann, a mathematician. So in the Neumann boundary condition, what you have is that the first derivative or the gradient of the temperature is specified. So again, an example. Well, the example I'm giving you an example in this one dimensional case. So it could happen that mathematically this means is that for a 1D case, your dT by dx at some boundary let's just call this small a. Okay, so that small a is just a known value. So that so mathematically this means is that dt by dx, the derivative of temperature with x at a given boundary x equals x naught, is specified. Again, this is for 1D cases. Okay, I'm just representing this for 1D cases, but you can expand the idea for a 2D and 3D case as well. And we'll be working with that. So we'll be going to 2D and 3D problems. So you will get more clear about how to apply these conditions there. But let's try to understand what they mean first. So this is the mathematical idea, and this is not limited to heat conduction. It's a mathematical idea, true for all differential equations. So Neumann conditions provide us with the value of the derivative of the unknown. Now, where do we experience this kind of an equation, this kind of a boundary condition? Well, it's very common to have an adiabatic boundary. So I would let us say that the left boundary of this wall is being insulated. Okay, so that means that no heat can enter or leave this boundary. It's insulated. It's an adiabatic boundary. So examples will be adiabatic. So adiabatic boundaries will have Q double prime being zero. So no heat is exchanged. And we know from the Fourier's law of heat conduction for homogeneous materials, that means that minus K times dT by dx for this 1D case is zero. So that means dT by dx is zero. All right. So you can see that for adiabatic boundaries, you end up getting a Neumann boundary condition. Okay, so you solve for your temperature field in terms of the constants, and then you differentiate that with respect to x, and then put that equal to zero, and you obtain one of the constants. Ultimately, the idea of each boundary condition is to get one constant. Another situation that's given to us is a specified heat flow. So that's one. The other example can be that Q double prime is specified. It means I tell you that these many watts per meter square are flowing out or flowing in through a given boundary. It could happen. Okay? So if that is the case, then minus K dT by dx is equal to some known value. Yes, in that case, you'll have minus K. I'll call it Q double prime specified. So this again, right hand side is known to us. It's been specified to us, and this becomes, so in, again, this dT by dx becomes minus Q double prime S by K. So the right hand side is known. So you can mathematically find the value of dT by dx and put it to that specified value. Okay. And there's a third kind of boundary condition that we use as well. So I'll erase this equation and the first type. So mathematically, the third kind of boundary condition is called the Robin boundary condition. So Robin boundary condition says that you have a linear combination of your unknown, that is some known constant times your unknown, plus a known constant times the derivative of the unknown, and that is given to us. And this is again at a given boundary. So this is at x equals x naught, and this is at x equals x naught. So at a given boundary, let's say in this case, for example, left boundary, but x equals to zero, the value of temperature as well as the linear combination of the value of temperature and its derivative was specified. I mean, mathematically, it's a linear combination of the Dirichlet and the Neumann boundary condition. Again, you will ask me where exactly do we experience this. Again, this is very common. And an example is a convective boundary. So what that means is, let's say you have a boundary. So let's take this same wall condition, wall situation. And on the left-hand side boundary, which is x equal to L, you have you have a forced convection happening here. So what you have is you have a fluid flowing at T infinity temperature, which is trying to, let's say, cool down this boundary. And the heat transfer coefficient for that fluid or that combination is H. So in this situation, when we write the energy balance, again, the boundary temperature is not known. Okay. Of course, it's a steady state situation, so it will it reach some temperature, but we do not know what the temperature is. All that's given to us is that the left boundary is being cooled down by air flowing blowing at T infinity, and the heat transfer coefficient is H. That is what is known to us. So what we'll mean here is that in this case, the amount of heat that is Well, let's say the heat is flowing from left to right. Heating it, the convective boundary condition. So whatever heat is flowing as convection from left to right on this boundary is equal to the rate at which heat is conducting into the wall. So if I take a thin volume, like we did last time, then the rate at heat flows in. So this is Q double prime convection, that is equal to Q double prime conduction. And we know that the Q double prime convection is nothing but H times T surface minus T infinity. And that is equal to minus K dT by dx. That is at x equal to 0 in this case. This is at, well, T surface is your temperature, x equal to 0. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Any question?
Yeah, sir. Shouldn't be with the minus in front of H in the expression.
Can you say that again? Sorry, I missed that.
Sir, should not there be a minus sign in front of H there? Because if the temperature TS is greater, then mm-hmm. heat will flow in the negative x direction.
Right. Thank you. Thanks. So you're right. So we're assuming a heat flow from left to right. So T infinity has to be more than T surface. So then this becomes positive. And then if the heat is flowing from left to right, then dT by dx is going to be negative. And then this becomes positive. Thanks. Right. So if I move around the terms here, then what I end up getting is minus H T at x equal to 0 plus H times T infinity. And that is equal to minus K dT by dx at x equal to 0. So then I can take this dT by dx term on the left hand side and H T infinity on the right hand side. So I end up getting minus H T at x equal to 0, that's at the left boundary, plus K dT by dx at x equal to 0, that's again the derivative at left boundary, that's equal to minus H T infinity. That is again, this is known to us. Okay, so this is your A corresponds to minus H, your B corresponds to K, and C corresponds to minus H times T infinity. So in this situation, we'll apply this boundary condition, and you can see that this is nothing but of the third type, the Robin boundary condition. All right, any questions on this? You may also remember that the heat equation had a time derivative. So you had del T by del time. So that means that we'll also get a constant of integration from this derivative. So, but we only need one constant now. So we only need one boundary condition. And that makes sense because when you solve a problem, when you physically, if you think of a well-posed problem, then you would want to know what the temperature at T equal to zero is, because when we have this term, it is not a steady case, it's an unsteady case. Things are changing, the temperature is changing with time. So you would want to know what the temperature at T equal to zero was, time equal to zero. Okay. So the value of temperature at time equal to zero is to be specified. We call it T naught in most cases. And this T naught then will be a function of X, Y, and Z. So that means that we want to know the initial temperature at all the points in space to be able to find the future temperatures at all the points in space. So this has to be specified, and this is called the initial condition. Okay, so we tend to use the word initial condition for this value of temperature specified at a given time. And then we use the word boundary condition, which is the value of temperature specified at a given boundary. And the conditions we discussed about is true for all the times. So that means for the boundary conditions, when you specified T at X equal to zero as the Dirichlet boundary condition, then that was true for all times. So I can put, so whatever time I have, the temperature on the left boundary still is TL, for example, in this case. Okay, so now let's come back to this steady one dimension example that we were discussing. Let's move around these terms. Or let's try to find the heat transfer, rate of heat transfer from here. Okay, so I can find my Q double prime, which is minus K dt by dx. So if I differentiate this with respect to x, this term vanishes, and all I have is minus K times T right minus T left divided by L. Now, if you remember, we talked about the idea of thermal resistance, where we said that we tend to write the heat rate of heat transfer, or the heat flux, well, sorry, the rate of heat transfer as the temperature potential difference times, V equals IR, so this is divided by the thermal resistance. So it's analogous to our electric current, electric circuits. So here also we want to do the same. So if I take this equation, so this is again an analysis for our 1D steady situation. So if I take this equation, then what I have is Q double prime is minus K TR minus TL by L. And remember that Q was Q double prime times area. Okay, so this was watts per meter square. So we can get the value of Q as, for this situation, minus KA divided by L. And this TR minus TL is your potential difference. So I'll call this delta T. Okay, well, I will absorb this minus sign in the temperature potential difference, because again the sign is clear, it always flows from high to low potential. So this becomes TL minus TR, and in this case that is positive because TL is more than TR, and that's the reason heat flows from left to right. So I won't worry about the sign here because I know that heat flows from high to low temperature. So then the thermal resistance we have here becomes L by KA. So this means that I can write my thermal resistance as L by KA. So for a conduction situation, my thermal resistance is equal to L by K. And that's a very common idea. I mean, that's a very very commonly used idea for designing resistances. So like in heat currents or heat circuits, you have been to find a resistance of 10 ohms, given you have two 5 ohms resistances, you take them in, you connect them in series, you get a 10 ohm resistance. Similarly, if I want to have an increased thermal resistance and I only have these sheets or plates of lower resistances, then I can connect them in series. So we can use the same ideas to either increase or decrease the resistance. So if you have two resistances of 10 ohms, you want to get a 5 ohms resistance, you connect them in parallel. You can do the same thing here. So this is what brings us to the idea of thermal resistance. But before we start talking about composite walls, where we connect sheets to get the desired resistance, let's talk about the idea of thermal resistance for convection and radiation as well. We have briefly talked about it, but let's revise that, because the examples we'll be considering will have thermal resistance for each situation. Now, so this was conduction. So let me write that. So for convection, if you remember the Newton's law of cooling, so we wrote Q was equals to HA times T surface minus T infinity. So this T surface minus T infinity was nothing but the potential difference. So we'll call it delta T. Okay, so that means your thermal resistance becomes 1 divided by HA for a convection situation. Now for radiation, if you remember again that Q was sigma epsilon, and then T to the power 4, that was the heat that was leaving or emitted by the surface, and the heat that was gained by the surface was T surrounding to the power 4. And then you had an area as well. So this was the expression for the watts or the rate of heat transfer out of a surface because of radiation. Okay, so I can factorize this expression. So what I will get is, this becomes T minus T surrounding times T plus T surrounding. So that's T square minus T surrounding square. And then you have a T square, plus a T surrounding square coming from the factorization as well. Okay, so this, all these three terms multiplied give us a T to the power 4 minus T surrounding to the power 4. Now in this case, my delta T is nothing but T minus T surrounding. So I will call this T minus T surrounding is the temperature difference between my surface temperature and the surrounding temperature. So I can call that the potential difference. So this is my potential difference, and everything else that I have is contributing to the thermal resistance. So the thermal resistance in this case becomes 1 divided by these terms. So 1 divided by sigma epsilon A T plus T surrounding times T square plus T surrounding squared. Okay. In fact, you can write the thermal resistance for radiation as the same as 1 by HA, where your H is given as sigma epsilon T plus T surrounding times T square plus T surrounding squared. I'll just Okay, so the idea is again a very straightforward of the use of thermal resistances. So let's see how we use this idea to solve a given problem. So let's take a situation where you have, well, we'll keep this for later. So let's take a situation where you have, again, your thick plate. So it's a pseudo 1D case. The heat transfer is happening from left to right. And what you do is, well, this is at a temperature T high, and this is at a temperature T low, but you don't know these temperatures. It's just that what you're doing is you are keeping this at T high by allowing some convection with a hot fluid, and you are keeping this T low by doing some convection with a cold fluid. So you're there's some cold fluid flowing. So you have let's call it. So the book calls it T infinity 1, and this is T infinity 2. So infinity is usually used for the fluid temperature as a symbol. So T infinity 1 is the temperature that's for the hot fluid. So I call it the hot fluid that is ensuring high temperature on the left wall. And you have a cold fluid at T infinity 2 that's causing the heat transfer because of convection on the right wall. Okay, so the left wall is x equals 0 and the right wall is x equals L. So that's the situation. And on the right hand side, you also have some sort of surrounding. So you have radiation losses happening from the right hand side as well. Okay, there's no radiation loss from the left side, but radiation loss is there on the right hand side. Okay, this is something that's given to you. So we also have radiation loss on the right side. So what we'll do is we'll try to develop a thermal resistance circuit for this situation. So what's happening is that heat is flowing from left to right because of convection. Then the same heat that was flowing gets conducted into the system, and then out, then from on the right hand side, some heat flows through convection and some heat flows through radiation. So if I was to write or develop the circuit for this situation, then what I'll get is the left hand side temperature is T infinity 1, and then you have R convection 1. Okay, so that's because of this hot fluid, and then you have a TH, which is the left wall temperature. Then you have a conduction resistance, so R conduction, and then you have your TL, that's your right hand side wall temperature, and then from here some heat flows due to radiation, so that is R radiation, and some heat flows through convection, so that is R convection 2. And the temperature for on the right hand side of R convection 2 is T infinity 2. And the temperature here is T surrounding. Okay, so T surrounding may not be the same as T infinity 2. So the surrounding temperature is something ambient temperature, and T infinity 2 is the fluid temperature. So this is the thermal resistance we have for this. So what is given to us? So T infinity 1, the hot fluid temperature is given. The cold fluid temperature is given, the surrounding temperature is given. So TH and TL are unknown temperatures. Now R convection 1, if you remember, this was 1 divided by H1 times A. Okay, so A is the area of this complete cross section. So that is given to us. Okay, so R convection 1 is given because H1 and A are known values. R conduction is L divided by KA. So again, that is something that is given to us because the length or the thickness of this plate is given, thermal conductivity of this material is given, and the cross-sectional area is given. Similarly, R convection 2 is also given, H2, and this R radiation, which was 1 divided by H radiation A. Now, that is something that depends on this RH radiation depends on T surrounding and T as well. So that may be a challenge, but that creates some nonlinearity. But let us say your H is also given to you for radiation. So in that case, you can easily find the net resistance in the circuit. That is what you have been doing in your electrical circuits. You find the net resistance. So the potential difference ultimately is T infinity 1 and T infinity. You have to find, let's simplify this problem. Let's say that, because I'm just trying to show you how to use these ideas. So we'll simplify this. We'll say that T surrounding is equal to T infinity 2. So I've simplified my problem. So T surrounding is equal to T infinity 2. So that means that these two resistances now are in parallel, because they're at the same potential, so we can connect them. All right, so I can now solve for the net resistance, and then I can get the value of the current or the rate of heat transfer. And once I get the value of the current, so I'll be using the word current and heat rate of heat transfer interchangeably. So once I note the value of the current, I can find the potential drop across each resistance. So that means I can find the value of TH and TL as well. So whatever I have to find, everything can be found out now by using this idea of thermal resistance. It's an extremely strong idea, and you already have an intuition of connecting resistances in series, parallel, designing resistances, the idea of Wheatstone bridge and so on. So they're all valid for heat transfer as well. So that's the amazing idea of learning one field of physics and then being able to apply those in a related field as well. Okay, any questions on this? So I will not discuss a lot on this topic, because on Monday we'll be having a tutorial where I will be solving a couple of, I'll be uploading a tutorial on Moodle and send you an email on the mailing list, so you can try the problems yourself, and then we'll solve them in the class, in the online class on Monday. So Monday will be a tutorial where I'll be applying these ideas to a couple of real problems, so that you appreciate these ideas and how easily they are able to solve the problem, get the value of rate of heat transfer and temperatures using these ideas. Okay, so we'll be spending a lot of time on this, so I won't spend a lot of time right now. Well, so let's take an example, and again we can work together. So this example has it's called composite walls. So what you have is you have material, which is different materials connected to each other. In this case, you have four different materials. So the temperature on the left hand side is given as T1, and the right hand side temperature is T2. And these materials have different thermal conductivities. So this leftmost material has a thermal conductivity Ke, and the right one has a thermal conductivity Kh. The thicknesses are different. So this one is thickness Le, and this is LH. Then you have these two materials which have thermal conductivity Kf and Kg. And their thicknesses, well, lengths are the same, and they are of the same thickness. So this is, well, let's use the word, the thickness is P and the thickness is P. So all you have to do is you have to write or draw the thermal resistance circuit. So if I draw the resistance circuit, then I have a potential T1. Then there's a conduction resistance here, which is Le divided by Kea. Then I have some potential, which is unknown, so I don't know what the potential is. Then I have the current, which is distributing into these two. So I have two resistances here. The top one is L, let's call this LF. So LF is the same as LG. So I'll just use one symbol. So LF by AF, the area is A by 2 because this whole thing was A. So half of this is A by 2. And this lower resistance is again the same length. So LF by KG times A by 2. Now, let's say that these walls that I have here, so this whole wall is isothermal. So that means that this wall is made up of a material which has an extremely high thermal conductivity. So whatever temperature, if there's any temperature difference, it just equalizes quickly. Okay, it's an isothermal wall. It can happen. You have a highly conductive material that you pay, so it will have almost the same temperature. There'll be no temperature gradient across this because the thermal resistance across this wall will almost be zero. So that means that you end up getting the same potential, and then you have another resistance, which is LH by KH times A, and this is T2. So that's the thermal resistance for this composite wall. And again, I mean, it's a very simple idea and there's nothing complicated about it. So if you if something's not clear, then you can just sit for a couple of minutes and then it will start making sense. Now remember that the assumption here was that this whole wall was isothermal. Now there's another case possible where I'll modify this problem now. So I will say that instead of having an isothermal wall, what you have is, well, the wall is not isothermal now. And this wall is now adiabatic. Okay. So, these two walls are not isothermal, and this center wall separating F and G is adiabatic. So that means that there is no heat transfer happening between these two. Moreover, since these two walls are not isothermal, so that means temperature gradient can exist. So what happens is some heat flows from here, and then it splits into two. So now what's happening is that this temperature and this temperature can be different. So if these two temperatures are different, then that means that the heat that is flowing between T1 and this temperature and the heat that is flowing between T1 and this temperature is different. So when I model my system as a thermal resistance or a circuit, then what I get is a situation like this. So the current flows through these two materials, and whatever current flows to the left wall on the top does not transfer to bottom. So that means that you have whatever current entered on the top side on the left of KF is what flows through KF, and then that current then flows out to T2. So you see that we get a completely different circuit if I change my assumptions from isothermal walls to non-isothermal walls and an adiabatic center wall. So what I want to impress upon you here is that the circuit is dependent on, because it's a model, we are modeling the system as a resistance, thermal resistance circuit. So in this model, the model that we develop is dependent on the conditions on how, what kind of behavior do the walls show. So when you join two surfaces, the how do you join them, what's the property of the contacting wall is defines what kind of a circuit you will get.
Okay, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, since we are assuming 20 flow, so then what's the point of adding a adiabatic wall at the center? It is redundant since we are already assuming a 1D flow. Since we are already assuming that there is a 1D heat flow in this column. So what is the point of
1D assumption is not forced on us. So what happens is, for a given situation, we can't say to start with that the situation is 1D. It could happen that the heat can transfer in, flow in other direction as well. Okay, it is just that depending on the behavior of the problem, the flow is one dimensional. Okay, so 1D, if you're solving a problem, it may be given to you that you can assume 1D heat transfer. But in a real situation, you may have to decide yourself whether the problem actually behaves in a one-dimensional way or not. Okay, so since we talked about contact between surfaces and that defines how the model will be, let's talk about contact, an idea called contact resistance. Okay, it's an extremely important idea. I won't take too much time here. An example is, you may have heard of microprocessors, your computer processors. If you assemble your own computer, what you must be doing these days is that you have your processor, and since the processor is producing lots of heat, so you paste a heat sink on top of it. Okay, so if it's a liquid cooled heat sink, then you paste it on the processor. But when you paste it, you have to use a special kind of material. It's called a thermal paste. Okay, so it's a highly conductive paste, and the reason we do that is because when you contact two surfaces and you just take a microscope and look at it, then the surfaces are uneven. And if it's contacting another surface, then what you'll see is that the other surface will also be uneven. So what happens is that you have when you calculate the heat flow, so what's happening is there is some heat flow which is happening through this region, which is in contact with each other. So we this total area that we have of contact, we break it into two parts. So one part we call the Q contact. So this we'll call Q double prime contact. And the other part is the Q double prime gap. So you have two resistances which are in parallel. So you can design this, you can model this system as two resistances. So one is your thermal resistance for contact, which is low, and the other one is thermal resistance for gap, which is high if you do not use any thermal paste or material. So that's air here. If there's no material, you just use a normal glue, you'll be left with lots of air or some material which has a low thermal conductivity. So what will happen is that if this RT gap is very high, then you know that you will end up getting high resistance in the circuit. So what's happening is that this, think of it in terms of the current flow. So the current only can flow through the contact area, but not through the gap. Okay, so to increase the rate of current flow, what you want to do is you want to decrease the resistance of this region as well. And the way you can do that is you can fill it with a material which has very low thermal resistance, which is called a thermal paste. Okay, so when we do that, then the contact resistance, or the total resistance of the contact reduces, and you end up getting high rate of current flow or the high rate of heat flow, and hence you can quickly cool the processor. The other way to reduce this resistance is to press them. If you can somehow press the two materials, what will happen is that you will increase the contact area. Okay? And when you increase the contact area, then since this resistance is smaller than this resistance, if you don't fill it with anything, then you end up getting a better heat flow through the entire surface. It's a very important idea, so I thought I'll mention this. Remember, it's extremely important whenever you paste two surfaces to create a composite wall, you must use a thermal resistance or a thermal paste. Otherwise, you might end up making things quite worse. So I'll stop here, and then if you have any questions, you can ask.